Thanks very much for attending. Can I just welcome everyone, and given the fact that we have new members and officers who may not be known to members, I'd like to suggest we start with going around the table and introducing ourselves to each other. Can I also request specifically that when you are going to speak, you use the microphone in front of you rather than trying to speak in a loud voice. That way it enables everyone in the room to hear effectively what you're saying. So I'm going to start. My name is Tony Jones and I'm the chair.
Mark Smith, council officer, lead commission for the environment.
Carl Mal, team leader for performance and scrutiny.
Steve Babs, councillor and vice chair.
Brian Kenny, councillor.
Ron Abbey, councillor.
Sharon Jones, councillor. Christina Mustard, councillor.
Hi, Nate Arnold, councillor, Pansy-Lewin.
Tony Smith, councillor.
Tommy Cossier, councillor, Pansy-Lewin.
David Ball, assistant director of major growth projects and housing delivery.
Anyway, I'm Alan
Rayner,
Councillor
for Oxford.
Hello, I'm Jerry Ellis, I'm Councillor for Pollock and Ellsworth.
Mary Jordan, Councillor for
Passbridge. Bruce Berry, Councillor for North West Solomons.
Andrew Hodgson, Councillor for Haswell.
Alan Sykes, Councillor for Passbridge and Conservatives for Ellsworth.
Patrick Sebastian, committee officer, clerk to this committee.
Ken Abraham, the Swiss Dam, clerk and lead advisor to the committee.
Okay, thank you very much, everybody. Can I just ask if there are any declarations of interest or party looking arrangements? No? Okay, thank you. Agenda item 2 then. Prove the accuracy of the minutes of the last meeting held on 28 March 2018. Now, I know we've had a change in membership, but there'll be some folks who were here at the meeting who could perhaps propose and second if they did true record.
Can I just ask
some
considerations? Can I just have an alteration? On page 3, the last paragraph, it says in response to comments from Councillor Tony Jones, it was actually comments from myself.
Right name, wrong surname. Thank you for that. Anything else? With that amendment then?
Yeah, I'm going to just record it.
Thank you. Thank you. Okay, next item on the agenda is a presentation on the local plan. David?
Thank you, Chair. Good evening, members. Just a quick update on where we are. Since I last reported to this committee, I'm pleased to report that the plan preparation process, we've been able to look at that in detail and able to accelerate that process. The Council's made extra resources available to progress that in terms of staffing. We will be bringing a report on the local plan to Cabinet on the 23rd of July. That report will set out, when it's finalised, the current position. It will look at a number of land options and also contain information about housing requirements and fears. Members probably saw the press coverage yesterday and today in relation to a number of these issues around the local plan and the Greenbelt. At this moment in time, we have no decision from the Secretary of State with regards to intervention. We're still awaiting his view on that. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, David. Do we have any members who wish to ask questions or offer any comments? No?
Let's see what is there.
Okay. Thank you very much, David. Thank you for your time.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. Thank you, members.
That brings us to item four then. Can I invite Kevin McCallum to deliver a presentation on the Woodward Review?
Where do you want me, Chair? I was going to do a PowerPoint. Do you want me to do it there, or would it be better? Would it be better at the front of the
studio? Wherever it's most convenient for you, Kevin.
Prefer not to be there, yeah? Alright, so my name is Kevin McCallum, I'm the head of Commons Council. So thank you for inviting me along tonight, and thank you for scheduling on our Rainbow Dog football. Well, we're about to stage some kind of 24-hour pub, and that's not good for our second figures really. So I'm going to talk tonight about Worldview, the print publication, as well as the change in digital communications which we launched alongside it. I'll talk through what we've done, what's worked, what hasn't worked, and just have a conversation with you about what it looks like at the moment. And through you, Chair, at the end, I'm more than happy, obviously, to take any questions as well. Worldview launched in October 2016. It was a cabinet decision in April of that year, following from that, we had quite a bit of different discussions in terms of conversations with government. I called in this very room, a special council, various other things. We started in October 2017. Given we don't do Worldview publications in Perth, and we've had a number of different elections, local, national and regional, in the past couple of years, we've done 17 editions up to now. The last one was our 17th. The next edition goes to print next week, and it'll publish the following weekend. In terms of how it's put together, it's printed by one of the main media partners in the borough, the organisation which used to be known as Trinity Mirror, not called Leaf PLC. It's distributed also by local. I'm going to talk about both of those issues in a little bit more detail later on. The rest of it is done by us. We do the vast majority of the photography. We design it ourselves, we write it, sub it, and edit it ourselves in house. Alongside Worldview, their publication, we launched worldview.com alongside a slightly different approach to how we handle social media and the way we talk to residents online, basically. We did that for a number of different reasons, really. Number one was that world.gov.uk, the standard council website, wasn't being used by people to find out information about what the council was doing. 83% of people that visit worldview.gov.uk would find the website from a search engine. So they'll search for planning applications in Will, foster care in Will, you know, various parks in Will. They'll go to the page they're looking for, they'll visit a maximum of four and then leave. That's almost 85% of people do that. Only less than 10% type in will.gov.uk and have a little look around at what we're doing. And that 10% is us, if not residents. So we made the deliberate decision to disaggregate our news and information into a separate site, and we point all of our social media and promotional activity at that, a site that's purely about telling people what's going on in the world. So the world.gov.uk site effectively became a version of an online customer service rep, a world.gov.uk was our communications website. Many, many councils are doing this now. Liverpool have got Liverpool Express, Knowsley have got Knowsley News, this kind of approach is popping up all over the place now because people are seeing the numbers and how people are interacting with councils online. We also changed our approach to social media. Social media used to be was having a conversation with people about the bins getting missed and put our press release on social media. We changed that. We have conversations with people on social media now. We do our best to anyway. I've used an example put on the screen, which is about the tower over the bridge, and I'm telling that this to everybody. I see at the moment they're just baffled me at the time. When the bridge got opened last week, we put out a 30-second video telling people that it was open and telling people I apologise for how long it's taken. In the first, actually I should say 24 hours, we put it out at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. I checked it when I came in at 9 o'clock the following morning, and it had been viewed 94,000 times. I can't quite get my head around that, but it was shared 1,500 times and viewed 94,000 times. The work we've done over the past couple of years has given us a real reach on this kind of stuff can't work. What we've also done relatively recently, on the back of the GDPR legislation which came in, You've heard me when I've come here before to talk about budget consultations about our email database that we use to actually communicate with residents. GDPR spiked that database because the way we collected the data from different parts of the organisation, people who register for consultations, people who apply for funding, people who join libraries. We used to be able to email all of them about various things that the council was doing. We can't anymore. So what we did was before GDPR came in, we launched an e-edition of Littleview, and it was effectively a very short one-page email newsletter that goes out once a week. We start building up our database again. From the first two editions of that, we've now got 13,000 residents signed up to receive weekly editions of Littleview. That seems to be popular. It's a better length, three or four stories on it, it's quite easy to understand. That seems to be going well and it's popular. I'll start going through the publication itself. So I'll start with the two of the issues which I imagine are going to form an awful lot of questions that we get this evening. The first one was advertising. The first thing to say is that if you go back to the capital report at the beginning, it was never about generating revenue, this publication. It was a little bit of added value that we added on at the end. If I had the time again, I wouldn't have added that on at all. The minute that we went live with Littleview and the idea to get Littleview, we were lobbied extremely hard by Littleview about the potential that we were going to be taking money directly out of their bottom line. Then, to be fair, they've got to be. So we made a series of commitments that we would, as I've said on the screen there, we price ourselves much higher and we wouldn't deliberately target their customers. We'd accept advertising business, but we wouldn't go out actively selling. A couple of members have made points to me recently, including Councillor Gilchrist has mentioned it to me. Adding that income target in means that if you don't achieve the income target, there's a problem for the council budget. We're trying to now mitigate that at the moment. Now you'll have seen on the will.gov.uk website we started accepting commercial advertising and sponsored content. We've also done that on Littleview as well. That's a national company that we've signed up with called the Council Advertising Network to sell on our behalf. We're expanding our outdoor advertising sales as well. Just to cover the fact that we're just not going to push Littleview as a revenue generating exercise, because we just shouldn't do. This has been the most difficult thing that we've tried to get done. Now, when we launched Littleview, I knew we were in for a battle. In terms of the government, in terms of the challenge we were going to get, in terms of the potential reaction of the local media, perhaps naively, I thought paying somebody to stick the thing through a letterbox would be pretty straightforward. Turns out it's not straightforward at all. We're on our second supplier, and our third different model for distribution has been by far the biggest challenge we've had. It's intensely frustrating, it's embarrassing, and it's nowhere near good. We're having weekly conversations with the supplier at the moment. We're having a daily conversation with various members of different community organisations, and it's almost like we're chasing the problem around the corner. So once we get a report that it's not getting delivered in a particular patch, we hammer the supplier, it gets delivered there next time, and then the problem pops up somewhere else. It's like whack-a-mole almost. We're just chasing it down. I'm in a contract. I'm working on different proposals, which I'm going to be taking to Cabinet in the next couple of weeks. I can't get into much in the way of detail about the new proposals other than to promise you I'm on. And I'm finding a way to make this right. But it's not working at the moment and it needs to. In my opinion, I'm going to go through the product that people will have. This is my opinion. People have got different views around the table. I think that's a good product we've got. I think people that are reading it are actually valuing it. This is overshadowing it, because this is just not good enough. This should be simple and it's not. We're going to try and fix it as much as we can. The publication itself, our partners are very supportive of Littleview. They think it is. Now, this was part of our point at the time, in that Littleview doesn't carry news as such. It carries information for people, but it's written in a way that makes it interesting. It's not just a list of services that you can access. We try and tell the stories in a certain way to be helpful to people, but also provide important information. It's not news. Now, news space in the Echo and the Globe and every publication in the country is incredibly valuable in a competitive market. It's shrinking all the time as advertising budgets decrease as well. Community organisations, the NHS, everybody finds it really difficult to get this kind of information into the paper. We've met that need. We offer that service to community organisations and all of our partners across the region to get information out to people. We actually get too much now. I'm at a position now where we're actually having to turn down content. because people are giving us too much. If I can only get it actually distributed to people, this might be actually a really good idea or not. We're consistently getting people coming to us with content ideas and giving us story ideas. Every single edition we're getting people sending us various bits and pieces of events, all sorts of different stories. If I just give a couple of examples of that from the last couple of front pages. The first page, page one, which is an extensive coverage of all of our cultural events over the coming year. How to access them, where to go, where to take your kids during the events, alongside the photography. But across the bottom, which is the cover, which you call the teaser panel, I've got no idea what Paul Young was doing in there. I can't remember what that story was, so sorry about that. But the street lighting placements, a program of road improvements, not popular illnesses, antisocial behaviour and suffrage movements. All really helpful information for people. And we try and meet that standard every single edition and we'll be giving more of that. Similarly, in the last edition, I'm sure quite a lot of you went to the Animated Square in Birkenhead, but the Tramia Rovers events, the PSPO, cycle schemes, and there's a range of stories that are actually helpful to people every time. This is the most popular element of the publication, which is what's on there. There is genuinely real competition to get the space for that. We're probably going to have to look to expand that into 8 pages in future editions, because we've got organisations right the way across the region now trying to get us into this. The Florida Pavilion, I've seen a massive increase in business, particularly around the Panto season when we've been doing really extensive promotions on this. This is becoming really popular and almost worthwhile to talk. So much here, then I'll pass over to yourself. We have used Will of You to massively improve how we communicate with online and through social media. We've got a decent reach now, a much better reach than we ever had before. We've given community organisations and partners with a good chance, but we have not got the distribution now, and we've got to get that, we've got to fix it. Jake.
Thank you, Kevin. Comments, questions? Jenny?
Kevin. Well, I don't understand why you haven't got the distribution right, because I would have thought at any reasonable level of management structure in your department, they would know who to go to get distribution done. And then it would be done, and all they're going to do is get the copies delivered to them, and then we'll take them and put them in people's hands. I mean, we got a copy of the Middleview, two copies of the Middleview, the first 2 months. Haven't seen any since. And it's just an ordinary residential area. And why can't you just tell the people to do it, or just get rid of them and get somebody else to do it?
It's like, should I just do you then, Jane? Okay. You're quite right. We have, as I say, the event, the contract with our supplier. We've moved to a different supplier and changed the distribution model within there. It's frankly, it's ridiculous that this can't pick up. The contracts in this industry are written in a certain way, and that makes it very, very difficult to do much around it. What I've also said is that we're not the only people doing this kind of thing. There are 7 of these across the country. I've spoken to my equivalents in every one of those organisations. And if I use one example, which is Hackney today in Greenwich, who are both doing similar things. Hackney is 7 square miles of densely populated housing. They've been doing this for 15 years. They still have these problems. Same problems that we have. It's the nature of the industry. We need to find a different solution. As much as we keep kicking the supplier, at the end, it's teams of young lads who are on, frankly, minimum wage living wage, who they're bound to do half of it and not fair to them. That's what happens. They're not doing it for a career, they're doing it short-term casual work. That's what we're having all the time. And I haven't got much in the way of confidence that if I sat this supplier, move to a new one, it will be exactly the same. I need a new model.
Thank you. Adam?
Thank you, Chair. Thanks for the presentation. You did mention that advertising was never part of the model, but it was included as part of offsetting the cost, wasn't it? So what impact has that had on the actual budget for the World View if you haven't had the advertising? And also related to that, do the partners pay for their advertising? Are they paying at the above market rates that you mentioned compared to the Globe and Echo?
Okay, so I think I'm trying to mention in the presentation that if I had the time again, I wouldn't put the income target in, but you're quite right, it gives an impact. We had the target last year of 80,000, we did just over 30, something like that. I've mitigated that as best I can. So I think it still left us with a hole of about £10,000, which I tried to squeeze from different costs and things like that. So it didn't result in an overspend, if you like, so I've had to really mitigate it. I'm launching new products to compensate for it. In terms of partners, there is a partner rating, but they're still more expensive than the market. They're online as well. If I just give a bit more information on that. Partners pay for advertising, they don't pay when they just give you content. If you give your story, I'll carry it. If you want to do a half page ad, I'll charge. So it's two different things. If I don't park once, when I want to announce a community event, I will.
So, I mean, obviously you want to help partners, but they obviously got a PR budget themselves, haven't they? So, they're not spending their budgets and we're picking up for them. I mean, we want to be good partners, we want to engage, but they have got money to do the same thing, and we need to obviously use it for our residents. Can I just ask a quick question about the digital side of things? So, originally when this came about, I suggested that we should be looking more digital, because that's more of a modern process. And we sort of shot down and said, the people who want it, the people who are online, that was a big issue for why we shouldn't be going down the digital route, we should be having a print version.
Yeah.
So obviously now you're saying that the digital version is doing okay. I mean,
yeah.
13,000 for the newsletters is a small proportion of the residents overall, isn't it? I was just wondering, when you mentioned the hits, how's that looking in terms of unique views, so actually number of visitors rather than just hits to the website?
Yeah, that's a good question. So can I just pick up the previous one you mentioned about part contributions, I agree with that. That's right. In terms of what we said originally, I think if you go back to the original cabinet report, we made the point that we wanted to do a print publication, but that it would also be complemented by improved social media and online presence. When you write a communications plan, and you will have all done it in either in your work or in your political careers, you will have written a comms plan, you write a communications mix. You write channels, different channels. You don't pick your favourite channels and concentrate on that. So we always knew we were going to do both. It wasn't an either or. So when we did the digital channel alongside, we wanted to keep building that up, but we just knew that having a physical product was just going to help everything else you got. That was our original view of it. In terms of the hits versus impressions, I can't remember. I'll find out.
Thank you.
Thanks, Kevin. Christine?
Thanks for that, Kevin. First of all, I'm going to say that from the community groups I'm involved in, we found it really useful because we did a test on why people had attended an event, and a lot of them we found out about it from Worldview. And given that most people in the Royal South don't seem to get it, that was good. So clearly, the internet's worked on that. What I wanted to ask you is, down our end of the borough, we also have the standard, which is given out at the shops, and doctors and libraries and things. And if we did something like that, apart from paying for the metal stand, we wouldn't have to pay for the distribution, and as long as people knew where to get them from, I just feel that might be another way of looking at it.
If I can follow up on that, Jay, that's a fundamental part of the proposal we put together. We think we can get out to about 350 local locations with the stands and supplements and tools through those door distributions. That's a big part.
Thank you.
The metro model is
standard.
Yeah, no, the metro news, we've got kind of model of distribution, but it's very
important. Well,
they've
got to close market.
Yeah, it's that kind of thing.
Yeah,
kind of thing.
That's right.
Ron?
Reiterate the Echo is not a green paper, so we can't use the same content as the Echo. I pay for the Echo to be delivered to my house, so I get that news. The Globe does not get delivered to my house, it hasn't been delivered for the last 12 years, and I've got an expectation that it will be delivered in the future. So not every investor gets a Globe, I mean, because their readership, I think, was a couple of years ago, was something around about 30,000. But they deliver to households, so they don't get it. Not every household gets a Globe. And the same problem with news, Globe news died because the distribution area got smaller and smaller and smaller, where it became ineffective. And the issue that we've got is that it's difficult to get a free newspaper out. I don't get the Globe News. I'm one of the ones that seem to, I get it 1 month and I don't get it the next month. I don't get it for a few months. That's the problem we've got, is that issue.
Kevin's right, the people who deliver it are always not the most willing to deliver. They'll deliver some because they're getting paid a bit, and then they just get off their door off. And that's the reality going on with any free paper. The Globe has to pay their deliverers, and they don't get delivered to everybody. So we all are going to, well, it's a problem, it's a friendly problem, there's not a solution. It doesn't mean we should stop doing something, because it's a has to have a problem attached to it. We should be able to get it out to as many people as we can. And supplement it, as Christian suggested, in maybe areas that are focused within communities, and tell people. That's where we can get it from, is the illusion. The message is not going out to people, being certain venues.
So, shall I possibly follow up on one point, please, okay?
Yes, by all means, thank you.
I just wanted to just mention the Globe and some of the challenges they face. They do an incredible job of it. It's very, very difficult to do what they do. I live in Liverpool, I grew up in Baltimore. There used to be weekly newspapers, the Daily World on Bus, the Mercy Marks up on Bus, the Trophy Herald, but you don't really see that through the Times, you don't really see that. The Globe still does well, but it's funded by advertising entirely. So they deliver where their advertisers have got value. Which that's the business model, that's the only way you can survive. That's not a criticism of them, that's just the nature of that business, and they do really well to do what they do. That's why we did this, and we got the distribution right, that's why this will sit alongside the Globe and the Sorry,
thank you, Bruce.
Thank you, Chair. Thanks, Kevin, for your presentation. One of the, probably your comments, but to do with the new bridge opening, yeah. You were surprised the amount of hits that the I don't know why you're surprised by that, because that bridge was so far on the schedule and it completely upset thousands and thousands of people for the last 18 months or so. And people couldn't wait for that bridge to reopen. They were waiting for the moment for it to reopen. So, you know, that's one of the stories that would take all those hits. So I personally wouldn't be surprised about that. But the other point I wanted to make was that you talked about the problem with distribution, and you've been perfectly honest and frank about the problems that you've had. But there are a number of people within Wirral that do not want a delivery. Have you done any sort of work on that to see, you know, which people want it, which people don't? Maybe you could reduce the area that you delivered to?
Okay, so what we want to do, Chair, is exclude all areas from receiving delivery. What we have, I don't think that's fair, and I don't think you can call a community a homogenous or a homogenous area and say no one there wants it. That's not quite how this would work. So we're never going to do that. What we have got already in place is to do not deliver this. If people don't want to tell us, we'll put on a list, we'll get to the next.
Okay, thanks.
So
I've got Brian
and then Andrew. Yeah, thanks, Chair. Through you, Chair. Thanks, Kevin, for the presentation. Yeah, I personally think Willowview is an excellent publication. And I speak to lots of people who find it very informative, very interesting, very helpful. In fact, just one practical example, the latest edition of Willowview, which are a half page about the activities of the school children at Portland School when I was governor, because of the work they've done on promoting eco schools. I can assure you, I was at a governor's meeting on Monday this week where everybody was talking about the article that was in the Willowview, and I think that's a positive. I mean, the main purpose of the article was about single-use plastics, which is actually on our agenda tonight, which is important. But it's in getting the community involved, and the fact that they were all talking about it, you know, I think proves at least some of them have read it. But I think it made a very brave comment there, or some people might say foolhardy, Kevin. You actually said about the problems with distribution,
yeah.
And we all know there's been problems.
Yeah.
You said we will resolve them later this year.
Yeah.
You didn't say we hope to resolve them.
Yeah.
Are you that confident,
yes,
that the problems of distribution will be resolved?
Yeah, we will. What we'll never do, we will. It'll never be absolutely perfect. But this is not going to be an exact science. This is a big geographical area with all sorts of different communities and some urban and some rural settings. It will be massively better than it is now, and it won't be. And it won't, I'm hoping that it won't be some of the first few communities to explain distribution in the future.
We did say that.
Thanks,
Brian.
We did.
Andrew?
Thank you, Harry. what Brian was just saying, there are other points in the paper. Christina
actually stole my thunder, because I was going to mention about how you distribute it, because I know that's your biggest problem, it's not the content, and how you're going to get the content, how you're going to get it out. And I think she's right, Christian, where you put it in shops. When you go over to America, they have newsstands where people can all take one out. Can't we provide, or can't you buy, a place to put all over the community, where people can go in the street, you know where there's one, because there's a lot of older people who don't have the internet, and there are lots of good ways to get it to people. But I think we should have central points where people are made aware that the newspaper's going to be. I think that would help you with your history, which I don't think you're ever going to solve.
Christina's point was absolutely right, that's the fundamental part.
Yeah.
I'm going to bask
in the second thing, it is a genuine question. You know, it's a problem that people didn't distribute because of their name.
Yeah.
I thought it was non-political, so how does that affect it?
Okay, so, say to you, Chair. We originally planned to distribute the paper. It was very, very sensitive, because there wasn't at the time, if we think back to it. We made the judgment, we had a discussion with various politicians of different parties, we just made the judgment to say the pitch is not big. We could have done, but we just made the call.
Okay. Okay.
Tony?
Yeah, okay, thank you. Thanks for that presentation, Kevin. You know, I've been in communication various times with you and that over the distribution and that, and you've obviously accepted it. But what I find really difficult to understand, I can have it delivered at my, and people at the back of my house never receive it. So we have roads just beside me here, and we have an area of Upton since it started in 2016 and we've never received it. And I find that really difficult to understand. And I've actually seen a young person delivering on my road, but not actually delivering into every house, about four or five houses and spread out a little bit. And that it is young people doing it. The reliability is not, you know, it's not there. What percentage do we have distributed in the borough?
So it's a really important point. So there's a couple of things to answer that. Obviously, that the areas that you've highlighted, we've had a look into those. And believe it or not, we have actually the distribution company have got GPS trackers on the vans, so you can see where they are at any given time. So we actually see them pop up in that particular area, and we still don't get them delivered. So I just can't answer the question properly. In terms of percentages, I don't trust our numbers at the moment. We get as part of the distribution model. There's what's called a tracking system. So we do a little bit of door-to-door knocking, and we do a little bit of telephone surveys as well, which basically asks you, do you remember receiving a bill of you in the past 4 weeks? It's telling us between 85 and 90% are saying yes. I don't believe the number, because the level of feedback we're getting on the delivery just suggests to me that number is wrong. That people are mixing up bill of you with the goal, or that they saw it 6 weeks ago, I think it's last week. I'm not buying the number. The reaction when I said 85-90% suggests that it's probably not right, that number. I'm not really buying it, so I don't trust my research. So it's, I'd suggest it's quite a bit lower than that, but I just don't know. I don't think the number's right.
Thank you, Alan.
Thank you, Kevin, for your contribution. I think I must be living in a slightly different world from everybody else, because the people that I spoke to in Oxford during the election campaign and over the year really come out with the same point again and again. We don't get the paper, and if we do, we don't particularly want it. I'm sure it contains a lot of useful information, and it does take a long time to get a new publication established. But I think after 17 editions, the evidence that I've seen from talking to people, and I've talked to a lot of people, is that there isn't really that appetite for it, and I wonder if it's really worth the resources that we're putting into it.
My only answer to that should be that there's a big, I think there is a demand for it, and I think the people we're speaking to want it. But there's a big, with all the rapid opinions on that.
Okay, folks, thanks for that. Thanks, Kevin. Thank you, dear friend. Sorry?
No, I don't think we let the last word go on the negative. Quite frankly, I think it has had its critics, and that's true. I think most people will accept now that it is fairly benign politically. The fear, I think, for many people was that it would be a political publication, which it is certainly not. In fact, many people complain to me that's not political enough and you're not saying how it is and all that. So, well, that's the nature of it. The voluntary groups love it with a vengeance. I've spoken to numerous voluntary groups who say, post an item in there, everything goes on your volunteers, contributions, and everything. So, without that contribution, our point of view. But my view is, if we have to make any suggestions towards cabinet, is that we would produce this newsletter or this publication in e-form. So the way it goes into producing in e-form. So the basic way is there. Distribution is certainly an issue, but if we can save money on the distribution and the printing and make more people digitally enabled, then we can bring the two things together. Now, I don't know whether we're clever enough to know whether the money could be used that we spend on printing to actually enable people who are digitally enabled. But again, it's probably exactly as someone said, the same audience that we're targeting in the poorer areas, where poorer areas or isolated people who are less digitally accessible. So we can tackle the distribution issues simultaneously as enabling more people to be digitally enabled. I think we might have a product that is worth some.
Thanks for that, Steve. Ron?
Yeah. I'm going to have a slight disagree with Steve. I think there is a real value in that, but I'm not disagreeing on that. I'm disagreeing on the point that everybody's digitally enabled. But far from it, the reality is that what we need to be doing a bit more is the intelligent understanding where it's falling down in distribution. And I can tell you now, you get a bag full of that, and you've done them. Your bag's heavy. You don't want to be doing a second bag. So that's part of the intelligence. Yes. Understand, are they going back for seconds? Is there a bag park nearby that carries the things around? Or are they dumped somewhere and people pick them up? Or are they just dumped into the nearest wheelie bin? That's part of the intelligence of finding out what's happening with these things when we go out there. And how are they delivered and monitoring that the fact is what they're delivered. But there is a real need for this, for the message to go out to people about that. I can understand large parts of the box that may not want it. But do they know what it is? If they haven't had it, how do they know what it is to say I don't want it in the first place? That's the reality of it. You need to understand what do these people know about it, and that's part of the intelligence strategy. We need a bit more savvy in how we interrogate people and ask for that information back. It's easy to say, oh yeah, I do get it. Well, I get it, but I might get it once in Preston Gill. But that means I get it, but it doesn't mean that I get it every time. And then some people say, I don't want it. If you don't want it, do you know what you don't want? Well, you don't, do you? Because you're money.
Steve, you want to come back?
I don't think one was disagreeing with me. I didn't say everyone was digitally enabled. I said one of our visions must be to get everyone digitally disabled. And we use some of the resources saved from printing and delivering we've enabled digitally. Right. The other issue is, I'm not surprised people in Oxford don't want it, because every time we pick up a focus, we're told it's a load of rubbish and they're wasting money. So if we tell people it's a negative product, don't expect them to want it. So can we finish on that, Christian?
What would you say? Are we finish? Okay, folks, thanks very much for those contributions. We move on to agenda item 5. The extent and impacts of Fly Tipping on Will. And can I invite Rob Kane to do his presentation, please? Thank you, Rob.
I'm Rob Kane, and I'm the Senior Enforcement Officer in a team of 4 Environmental Enforcement Officers that deal amongst other duties with flight tipping and environmental crime on the road. And I've been asked to produce this report to provide an overview of the causes, impacts and remedies of flight tipping in Borough. Flight tipping can appear to industrial scale deposits by organised groups. But the reality is that within Borough, the vast majority of wasted reported sources.
Can I just cut across again? I see you can turn your microphone on.
I just wait for you to turn off, Chair. I apologise.
Thank you.
I can tell it's on and on. The vast majority of waste that is reported to us in Asbury is domestic waste, which is deposited on highways, open land, road passageways.
we don't see industrial scale harm for the hazardous waste, thankfully, on Wirral, unlike some of our neighbours. Fragmenting does reduce people's enjoyment of the environment and can lead to a spiral of decline in environmental quality. And the removal of this phytic waste also increases the authority's waste disposal costs. English councils have to report the number, scale, type and location of phytic instances to DEFRA. This is done regularly through the flight capture process. And the scale we have to report can range from single item through bag, cargo load, small van load, transit van load, tip truck load, or multiple tip trucks. Now, we don't get many multiple tip trucks tipped on Wirral, but we get lots of reports of multiple tip trucks of waste recorded through to DEFRA. This is because we take our data past the DEFRA directly from our customer relations management system when it's reported to us by the member of the public or the member that reports it, also the type of waste. So it is not the council's to find the type and amount of waste that we report, it actually comes directly from the reporting. Also, we can have multiple reports of single instances in popular or high visible sensitive locations, as you can imagine. Figure one within the report has demonstrated that recorded incidence of phytochem has been reasonably stable for a number of years. It's currently at between 2,000 and 3,000 instances, and it's been like that for quite a while now. Most reported phytochems are described as domestic waste, and most of the incidents reported on highway passageways, between 70 to 90% of all waste is dumped in passageways or on the highway. That's indicated on figure 2. Wirral Council does have a duty to keep highways clean and relevant land as well, land which is responsible, and keep it free from litter and refuse. This duty is discharged in Wirral through the street services contract, which was awarded to BIFA in 2006. Waste that's not on open land will not be removed by BIFA under this contract, and we can't ask them to do it. Responsibility for waste removal in some key land types was detailed on figure 3. It's private land, fundamentally, it falls to private landowners. It is statutory operator land, fundamentally, it falls to the statutory operator and not to the council. When the council does use the powers that it has to remove waste from private land, either through environmental health or the environmental enforcement teams, cost recovery is generally very slow and seldomly successful, and our teams only have a finite budget that we deal with the waste locations, where there's refuse nuisance, where there's pests, and such like. Any phytic that is reported to the council via the customer relations management system is investigated, and this is frequently by way of an actual visit to that phytic, because this is not always practical or necessary. I use the example of the sofa at the Alligator, which is a large number of types of phytics we get. There's no call to have an officer driving around looking at 30 furniture dumped at the end of entry, where you know there's going to be able to identify this kind of thing. This is just collected. Most phytic is household waste, and this is either deposited directly by the residents themselves or else it's passed to unauthorised or unregistered waste carriers who then take the waste and dispose of it unlawfully, saving money, taking money off the residents, but then saving it in fees by just dumping it. Residents do have a duty of care to check that they're passing the waste to an appropriate person, but many of them just don't think to check. They don't seem to be aware that just because it's their waste, once they've passed it on to somebody else, it's not my problem. Unfortunately, legally, there's still a duty, a legal duty on people to make sure it's not going to the council, they need to make sure it's going to somebody who's authorised to accept it.